Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is Pastor Raziel McFall, citizen of the Kingdom of God and ambassador of Christ. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, God said, "Let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion." My fellow believer, this was God's primary motivation and purpose for creating man. In the beginning, our God gave mankind kingdom and not a religion. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, Jesus outlines what should be the priorities of man. Every man should busy himself seeking God's kingdom and his righteousness. If the church is to be delivered from the limitations of this world and begin to experience the victory and abundant life that Jesus came to make available to us, we must become more knowledgeable about the kingdom of God and commit ourselves to walking in his righteousness. As you listen to the following message, it is our prayer that you receive insight into God's kingdom and be delivered from the spirit of religion that has held God's people captive for generations. God bless and strengthen you as you listen to the word of God.
Kings worship him today. Let the kings worship him.
We do believe that this is the dispensation where our God is revealing the mysteries of the kingdom to the people of God. And for this reason, as you are no doubt aware, our overall topic continues to be the kingdom of God. Now, I'm certain some of you might be asking, why this man? Why is Pastor McFall always speaking about the kingdom of God? Why am I always speaking about the kingdom of God? Well, as you may or may not be aware, back in October 2015, I saw some things in the Bible that I never saw before. And I don't mind telling you, I had been in church about 50 years at the time, but I saw a scripture, this scripture here in Luke chapter 16, verse 16. The Bible says the law and the prophets were until John. Then it says, since that time, the kingdom of God is preached and every man precedent in the kingdom. Do you see what the Bible says? This is Jesus Christ himself speaking, as a matter of fact. And so Jesus here announced a shift in God's agenda from the law and the prophets, or the Old Testament. The law is the first five books of the Old Testament, and the prophets are the remaining books of the Old Testament. And so Jesus said the law and the prophets were until John. And so Jesus is saying that the focus of God's agenda before John came on the scene was the law and the prophets. Then he said, since that time, since John's arrival, he said, the kingdom of God is preached and every man presseth into the kingdom. And right on the cue, my brother and my sister, the Bible says here in Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 to 2, think about it. Even though John the Baptist was the forerunner of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, John the Baptist came to prepare Jesus' way before him. But look at what the Bible says was the initial public declaration of John the Baptist. The Bible says, in those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea. John came preaching and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And so even as Christ Jesus announced the shift in God's agenda, as we just saw in Luke chapter 16, verse 16, the initial public declaration of the man who came to prepare Jesus' way before him was, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. As you are no doubt aware, eventually John was put into prison, and then Christ Jesus' public ministry began. Well, the Bible says in Mark chapter 1, verse 14, it says that after John was put into prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. And then in Mark 1 and 15, Mark lets us know exactly what Jesus preached. Jesus came preaching and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. And so just as John's initial public declaration was, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, Christ Jesus' initial public declaration was, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. And so notice, Jesus called this the gospel. Jesus called the declaration that the kingdom of God was at hand or had arrived on the earth, he called this the gospel. And then guess what? Well, in Matthew chapter 10, Christ Jesus chose 12 disciples And he gave them specific instructions. He told them what to say as they went out. Look at what the Bible says in Matthew chapter 10, verse 7. Jesus said, "As ye go, I want you to preach this message. Preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And so, my fellow believer, just as John's initial declaration was about the kingdom, Jesus' initial declaration was about the kingdom, and Christ Jesus sent out his disciples and tell them, "Listen, as you go, I want you to preach this message." And again, fellow believer, Christ Jesus taught his disciples to pray. What was the very first thing that he asked them to pray for? "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven." And how does the Lord's Prayer close? Well, in Matthew chapter 6, verse 13, the Bible says, "For thine is the," you guessed it, "kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen." And so we took another look in our Bibles back in October 2015, and we saw that practically every time Christ Jesus opened his mouth, he was speaking about the kingdom. In fact, Jesus gave us one priority, because we cannot disconnect the kingdom from the righteousness of God, because righteousness simply means to be in right alignment with God's kingdom. But Jesus told us the priorities that we should pursue in our lives. Here it is. This is Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. Jesus said, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." And so we took another look in our Bibles, and we saw this kingdom focus. And finally, just as the initial public declaration of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was about the kingdom, we saw that Jesus died and he rose again, and he never stopped speaking about the kingdom. Here it is. This is Acts chapter 1, verse 3. The Bible speaks about Christ Jesus. It speaks about how he showed himself alive to his disciples after his death, that's after his passion, by many infallible proofs. Then look at the highlighted portion of this scripture. The Bible says, "Being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God." And so, just as John the Baptist, the one who came to prepare Jesus' way before him, his initial public declaration was about the kingdom. Jesus' initial public declaration was about the kingdom. Jesus told his disciples, "As ye go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand." He taught them to pray, "Thy kingdom come." Clothe them to close their prayer, "For thine is the kingdom." He told them to seek first the kingdom of God. And again, we say Jesus spent his last 40 days on the earth before his ascension speaking about the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And finally, we know the Bible says that no man knows the day nor the hour when our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ will come. We don't know the day nor the hour, but we do know what will trigger the return of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Here it is from the Word of God. The Bible says, and I want you to know, I want to reiterate, that this is the only scripture in the Bible that tells us when the Lord is going to come. Here it is, Matthew chapter 24, verse 14. The Bible says, "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come." Do you see what Jesus said? He said, "This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations." This will trigger the return of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He said, "And then shall the end come." And so we just wanted to take a moment to let you know why we speak so much about the kingdom of God. Indeed, even as God's agenda shifted with the arrival of John, my fellow believer, back in October 2015, the focus of our ministry shifted to the kingdom of God. This is why our overall topic continues to be the kingdom of God. Well, as you can also see, our subtopic tonight is experiencing victory and kingdom authority through renewal of our minds. Again, our subtopic tonight is experiencing victory and kingdom authority through renewal of our mind. And so again, we say the kingdom of God is coming to you. We appreciate God for you taking time from your busy schedule. We want to get right into this word tonight, experiencing victory and kingdom authority through renewal of our minds. God bless you. And again, the kingdom of God is coming to you. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. We want to begin tonight with a word spoken by the Lord through the prophet Isaiah. Here's the word. This is Isaiah chapter 46, verses 9 to 10. The Lord encourages us here. He says, "Remember the former things of old." He said, "For I am God, and there is none else. I am God, and there is none like me." Now, in this scripture, our God is encouraging us not to forget the former things of old, or the things that happened in the beginning. He lets us know why in the very next verse. Here it is in verse 10 of Isaiah 46. He said, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. But before we get too deep into this scripture, I like what our God says here through the prophet. He said, I will do all my pleasure. Well, you know me, I'm a practical kind of guy, and if God say he will do all his pleasure, what I did was I went to see if Christ Jesus said anything about God's pleasure. And this is the only thing that I found Christ Jesus said about God's pleasure. Here it is in Luke chapter 12, verse 32. Jesus said, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. And so if our God said he will do all his pleasure, and Jesus said it is the Father's good pleasure to give us the kingdom, we can rest assured that our God has already given us the kingdom, my fellow believer. I believe that's great news for somebody. Our God has already given us the kingdom. He has restored the kingdom to us. But we don't want to get ahead of ourselves. But let's go back to the prophet Isaiah. Here's what Isaiah said. Isaiah said, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. Now, as we begin to analyze this scripture, let's take a closer look at this word counsel. Our God says, my counsel shall stand. What is this word counsel? Well, the word counsel is the Hebrew word etsah, that's E-T-S-A-H. This word simply means purpose. Just let us say one time that our Greek and Hebrew definitions are being extracted from the Strong's Concordance with Greek and Hebrew Dictionary. Here's what King David said about the counsel of the Lord. This is Psalm 33, verse 11. David said, the counsel of the Lord standeth forever. Do you see that? The counsel of the Lord standeth forever. He said, the thoughts of his heart to all generations. And consistent with the definition from the Strong's Concordance that we just saw, here's the Bible in basic English version of this exact same scripture. This is Psalm 33, verse 11 from the Bible in basic English. David is saying that the Lord's purpose is eternal. The designs of his heart go on through all the generations of men. And so with our understanding of the word counsel, let's revisit what our God said through the prophet Isaiah. Remember, God said, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. So our God is saying that my purpose shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. So let's analyze the full context of this scripture. God said, declaring the end from the beginning. Then he said, and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done. Then he said, his purpose shall stand, and he will do all his pleasure. So our God, in this scripture, he revealed what will happen at the end based on what happened in the beginning. Notice, God said, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done. So our God is simply letting us know that he revealed what will happen at the end based on what happened in the beginning. Additionally, because God's purposes never change, what he wanted in the beginning is still his desire, and it will be accomplished or done, because his purposes shall stand, my fellow believer. This means that we can understand or determine where we as believers or children of God are going, or what will happen in the future, by simply looking at what happened in the beginning. Again, we can understand or determine where we as believers or children of God are going, or what will happen in the future, by simply looking at what happened in the beginning. Our God said that he declared the end from the beginning, my fellow believer. So what does the first verse of the Bible say? Well, the Bible says here in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And so, what are the conditions that man experienced and enjoyed in the beginning? This is important because our God said that he declared the end from the beginning. And so, we need to understand what conditions man enjoyed in the beginning, because he declared the end from the beginning and from ancient times the things that are not yet done. And so we should be able to look at the conditions and the atmosphere that man enjoyed in the beginning, and we can get a sense of what will happen at the end. So whatever we experienced in the beginning, we will also experience in the end. So these are the conditions that man experienced in the beginning. Well, man was God's son and had a close personal relationship with him. The King of Heaven was man's God, and they were his people. Man literally walked with God. Man benefited from the presence of the King of Heaven. Remember now, these are the conditions that prevailed in the Garden of Eden. And if our God declared the end from the beginning, we can look at those conditions to receive or to get a sense of what conditions will prevail at the end. And so let's continue to review the conditions that prevailed in the beginning. Now, in the beginning, man had no pain, sickness, or disease. In the beginning, man had no sorrows or stress. Man had no guilt or shame. We know guilt and shame only came about after Adam and Eve rebelled against God. So in the beginning, man had no guilt or shame. Man was not fearful. Man bore the image and the likeness of God, as you are no doubt aware. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, our God said, "Let us make man in our image after our likeness." Man bore the image and likeness of the King of Heaven. Man had access to the tree of life and therefore had eternal life. Remember, man could have freely eaten from the tree of life. It's the tree of the knowledge of good and evil that God told man not to eat from. And so man could freely access the tree of life, and so man had access to eternal life. Man had unlimited access to everything that he needed. God gave man everything that he needed in the beginning, my fellow believer. Man had access to wealth and treasure, which had no material value because of abundance. Remember, the Bible speaks about the river that went out of Eden. It spoke about the good gold and the bdellium and all the other riches that were available to Adam and Eve in the beginning. And so indeed, man had access to wealth and the treasure, which had no material value because of abundance. We also saw from Genesis 1:26 that man exercised dominion on the earth under the delegated authority of the King of Heaven. Because earth was a colony of heaven, man lived in and was a citizen of the Kingdom of Heaven, where he experienced and enjoyed the quality of life under God's government. And so we're just looking at the conditions that prevailed in the Garden of Eden, because our God said that he declared the end from the beginning. And so we took a look at those conditions because we wanted an idea of what conditions will be like at the end. But generally, man experienced, enjoyed, and had access to the rights, privileges, benefits, power, authority, provision, protection, resources, life, light, strength, and overall sustenance of the Kingdom of Heaven, with continuous access to the King of Heaven. And so this is how man lived in the beginning. But again, remember what our God said. He said, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, "My counsel shall stand." We learned that counsel is purpose. "My purpose shall stand, and I will do all my good pleasure." And so, my fellow believer, everything that God wanted in the beginning, he still wants today. In fact, according to Isaiah 46:10, he was letting us know, he said, declaring or making known the end from the beginning. So here's a description of the physical manifestation of the Kingdom of Heaven in the New Jerusalem that believers will experience and enjoy in the age to come. I want you to see the conditions that will prevail in the New Jerusalem after Christ Jesus returns. Here it is. This is from Revelation chapter 21. Remember now, we just analyzed the conditions that prevailed in the life of mankind in the Garden of Eden. And we want to see, because our God said that he declared the end from the beginning. But here it is. This is Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 to 7. The Bible says in verse 1, John said, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth." We want to highlight the fact that John said that he saw a new earth. I know many of us learned in church that we are going to heaven and we will sing with the angels in the sweet by and by forever and ever. My fellow believer, there are so many things that we were taught in church that ain't true. We will not be in heaven forever. Heaven is like a holding station. Man was designed to live and exercise dominion on the earth, and this is where we will be. We will be in the new Jerusalem on the new earth. Let me show you this from the word of God. Bible says in Revelation 21 verse 1, John said, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. He said, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. Look at verse 2 of Revelation chapter 21. The Bible says, and I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for a husband. Do you see what the Bible says? John said he saw the New Jerusalem coming down from God out of heaven. And so indeed, we have been taught that we will be living in heaven for all eternity. But we will be living on the earth in the New Jerusalem. But the earth will be a colony of the kingdom of heaven, where the conditions in heaven will also prevail in the New Jerusalem on the new earth. But John said that he saw the New Jerusalem coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Here it is in verse 3. Now we want to see if the conditions that we just saw in the Garden of Eden will also prevail in this New Jerusalem, because our God said that he declared the end from the beginning. But here it is in verse 3 of Revelation 21. John said, and I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. That sounds just like the conditions that prevailed in the Garden of Eden, where God and man walked together in the garden in the cool of the day. But let's continue here. This is verse 4 of Revelation 21. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. No more tears, praise God. And there shall be no more death. Remember, man had access to the tree of life. Man had access to eternal life. John said, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. These are the exact conditions that prevailed in the Garden of Eden. In verse 5, John said, and he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. Now the newness speaks to restoration and renewal. The Bible says, our God, he who sat upon the throne, said, behold, I make all things new. And so our God is speaking about renewal. Remember, the Bible says that our God declared the end from the beginning and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done. He said that his counsel, he said that his purpose shall prevail. His purpose shall stand, my fellow believer. And so everything that our God wanted in the beginning, he still wants now. And he will replicate and restore the conditions that prevailed in the Garden of Eden, even in the New Jerusalem in the age to come. He that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. Here it is in verse 6 of Revelation 21. And he said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. Here it is in verse 7. He that overcometh shall inherit all things. We praise God. We learned in the previous lesson that the Bible says that we are joint heirs with Christ, and Christ Jesus was appointed heir of all things. And so if we are now joint heirs with Christ, and Jesus was appointed heir of all things, that means we have also inherited all things. And our God confirms this here in Revelation chapter 21 verse 7. It says, he that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. My fellow believer, man experienced the benefits of life in God's kingdom as his son in the beginning. And this is exactly what we will experience throughout all eternity in the age to come in the New Jerusalem after the return of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But what about the power to exercise dominion? Remember, the very first gift that our God gave man was dominion. In Genesis 1:26, the Bible says that our God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness and let them have dominion. And so if he's in the process of restoring the conditions that prevailed in the Garden of Eden, surely we will also be exercising dominion in the age to come. Well, here it is. This is Revelation chapter 20, verse 6. The Bible says, blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. on such the second death hath no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ. Look at the highlighted portion of this scripture on the bottom. And shall reign with him 1,000 years. My fellow believer, the same conditions that prevailed in the Garden of Eden will also prevail in the New Jerusalem, because our God said through the prophet Isaiah that he declared the end from the beginning. And so if you want to know what will happen at the end, you just need to look at how things were in the beginning. And so if we look at the conditions described here, you will notice that this is restoration of the conditions that mankind enjoyed in the beginning, my fellow believer. This is consistent with our God's promise to declare the end from the beginning and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done. His purpose and his will, they have not changed, my fellow believer. And he is a God of restoration. This is a description of what we will experience in the age to come after the return of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In the New Jerusalem, Jesus will return as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And our God declared, he said, behold, hey, I make all things new. He spoke about restoration of the conditions that prevailed in the Garden of Eden, because, my fellow believer, he declared the end from the beginning. But he has something that Paul said to us in his letter to the Hebrews. Here it is. This is Hebrews chapter 6, verses 4 to 6. The Bible says, for it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost. Here it is in verse 5 of Hebrews 6. And have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the world to come. The Bible says in verse 6, if they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh and put him to an open shame. Now, my fellow believer, we normally use this scripture to report that it is very hard and difficult and almost impossible for people who are born again, if they backslide, for them to be renewed to the Lord. And indeed, the scripture does imply that it will be a challenge for people who are seriously saved, if they backslide, to be renewed to the Lord, because the Bible says if they fall away, it is impossible to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh and put him to an open shame. But what we miss in this scripture is a description of those of us who are born again, those of us who have not backslidden. Paul describes us as follows. He said that we are enlightened. He said that we are tasting and enjoying the heavenly gift. He said that we are partakers of God's Holy Spirit. He said that we can taste and experience the good word of God. And finally, he said that we can taste and experience the powers. That's the abundance and miraculous ability of the world or the age to come. And so, my fellow believer, oftentimes we use that scripture to say that people who backslide, it will be difficult for them to be redeemed or returned to the Lord. But we miss the fact that Paul is actually describing you. Paul is letting you know that we can taste and experience the powers. The word power here is the Greek word dunamis. It means abundance, and it also means miraculous ability of the age to come. And so, my fellow believer, this means that as believers who remain in Christ, because we are partakers of God's Holy Spirit, we are now able to taste or experience the heavenly gift and walk in, experience, and demonstrate the blessings and the powers of the age to come, which is the environment and atmosphere of the kingdom of heaven. And so all of those conditions that prevailed that we just saw in the New Jerusalem, the Bible teaches that we are right now able to taste and experience the powers or the abundance and miraculous ability of the age to come. And so we are now able to taste or experience the heavenly gift and walk in, experience, and demonstrate the blessings and the powers of the age to come, which is the environment and atmosphere of the kingdom of heaven. But let's go back to the beginning to see what happened to mankind, which caused these conditions to no longer be a natural part of our lives and our experience. Remember, for some reason, Eve found herself speaking to a serpent. Now, God had given mankind dominion over all the animals, but Eve found herself speaking to this serpent. And in this conversation with the animal, she confirmed that she knew exactly the prohibition or the fact that God told them not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, Eve was well aware of the fact that this tree was off limits to them. But here's what the devil said and what happened thereafter. This is Genesis chapter 3, verses 4 to 7. We're still speaking tonight about experiencing victory and kingdom authority through renewal of our minds. But here's what happened. This is Genesis chapter 3, verses 4 to 7. The Bible says, "And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die." God told them that they shall surely die, but the devil tell Eve, "Ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened." Notice what the devil who had commandeered the body of the serpent said to the woman, "Your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil." Here it is in verse 6 of Genesis 3. "And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, that is, her flesh was activated." Remember, the Bible says that they that are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. All of a sudden, Eve began to malfunction. The Bible says that she saw that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise. She became soulish. She wanted to gratify her soul or her mind. Here it is. The Bible says she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. This is where man got in trouble. Here it is in verse 7 of Genesis 3. The Bible says, "And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, and made themselves aprons." Adam and Eve were victorious and exercised dominion when their eyes were closed. Again, Adam and Eve were victorious and exercised dominion when their eyes were closed. Now, I don't believe their eyes were physically closed. What this means is that instead of them dominating their physical environment, they positioned themselves to be dominated by it. Again, what this means is that instead of them dominating their physical environment, they positioned themselves to be dominated by it. And so when the Bible says that their eyes were open, the physical realm became the dominant realm in their lives. They were no longer being led by God's Spirit. They were no longer being governed by the Spirit of God on the inside of them. Opened eyes were a symptom of man's rebellion against and rejection of God. Again, opened eyes were a symptom of man's rebellion against and rejection of God. Here's what Dr. Bill Winston says in his book called The Kingdom of God in You. Dr. Bill Winston said, "If we are to reclaim the earth for God's kingdom, then we need to first understand that the supernatural, that's the invisible realm, is the foundation for all things. Remember, the Bible says that through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. And so everything that we can see and experience in the physical realm was actually made by things that we cannot see, by the spiritual realm." And so Dr. Winston went on to say, "The natural realm became predominant in human life when Adam and Eve fell." Dr. Winston went on to say, "After their eyes were opened, they became self-conscious rather than God-conscious." He said they became sense-oriented instead of spirit-led. Dr. Bill Winston concluded by saying they became limited to information in their minds rather than revelation in their hearts or their spirits. This is how man lived since the fall of Adam and Eve, and how we are naturally conditioned to live as a result of our period of imprisonment and incarceration in the kingdom of darkness. Remember, God drove man out. Man was spiritually expatriated into the kingdom of darkness. And every single one of us were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. We were born as residents and citizens of the kingdom of darkness. And so this is how man lived ever since the fall of Adam and Eve. Notice the emphasis on what happened to man's eyes as a result of their disobedience, rebellion, high treason, and the consequent declaration
of independence
from the kingdom of heaven. But not long ago, I learned something about sight. Here's what I learned. Despite what we have all been taught, we do not see with our eyes. Now, I know that might surprise you, but despite what we have all been taught, we do not see with our eyes. we actually see through our eyes, but we really see with our mind, which is determined by what's in our heart or what we believe. Again, despite what we have all been taught, we do not see with our eyes. We see through our eyes, but we really see with our mind, which is determined by what is in our hearts or what we believe. What we see is a result of our attitude, that's our mind, which is controlled and limited by what we believe. This is why two people can use their eyes to look at the exact same thing and see something entirely different and even opposite from each other. Again, this is why two people can use their eyes to look at the exact same thing and see something entirely different and even opposite from each other. Now, I've had the following picture on my phone for a very long time because I knew that at some point I would be able to use it in a message. Well, tonight is the night. Here it is. This is the picture. This is an image that I had on my phone for a very long time. We have two good gentlemen here. They're looking out of this window. They are both artists. As you can see, they are actually incarcerated. They are in prison. And so they are both looking out of this window. They're looking at the same image. But look at what this one painted. Look at what the other one painted. This guy painted the beautiful sun and the birds and the trees. And so even though they were both looking at the same image in the beginning, this good gentleman saw the bars that held them captive. But this one saw the beauty that was on the outside. My fellow believer, even though these two artists are using their eyes to look at the same image, they are each seeing something entirely different because of their attitudes, which is a product of what they believe. Now, another powerful example of this is the encounter of a lion and an elephant. Now, I heard this analogy in a message recently, and I thought it was so powerful and applicable to our message today. You know what? I'll just let Dr. Miles Monroe tell you about this encounter in his own words. Here is Dr. Miles Monroe speaking to us about this encounter of the lion and the elephant.
A lion will see an elephant, and the thing that comes to his mind, one word, lunch. Now the elephant is 10 times the size of the lion, probably 50 times heavier, and has more power. One stomp of his feet could destroy the lion. But when the lion sees the elephant, he doesn't look at size and weight and strength and power. He looks at lunch. I could eat this thing. And he acts the way he thinks. The size is not the problem. The weight of the elephant is not his concern. What makes him act is the way he thinks. And because he thinks he can eat the elephant, he attacks him. Now here's another amazing mystery. The elephant is larger, bigger, stronger, more powerful, heavier, and more intelligent. And yet when the elephant sees the lion, one word comes to mind, eater. The elephant is controlled by the way he thinks. He thinks that he is lunch. Therefore, his size, his weight, his power, his might, his authority is a victim of the way he thinks. It doesn't matter how big you are, how intelligent you are, how many degrees you get. It's your mind that keeps you small. And it doesn't matter how small you are, or how unintelligent you may seem to be, or how much you don't have. It's your mind that makes you the leader. It is the thinking of the person that makes them see circumstances differently. Attitude is a product of belief. You cannot have an attitude beyond your belief. So your attitude comes from your belief system. The lion is the king because of what he believes about himself and what he believes about the elephant and the giraffe. He believes that they are lunch, and he believes he can eat them. His belief system controls the whole situation when they meet. What you think is more important than what you do. And so if you want to change, you got to work on this attitude bit. Belief is so powerful, it can make an elephant act like a sheep in the presence of a lion. The elephant actually thinks it's a meal for a cat. To change your life, you must change your mind.
Dr. Monroe said a couple of powerful things here. What did he say? He said the elephant's size, weight, power, and might is a victim of the way he thinks. My Lord, he said the elephant's size, weight, might, and authority is a victim of the way he thinks. And so all of these resources that the elephant has access to are essentially neutralized by his thought process. Why? Because even though he's more powerful than the lion, he still sees himself as lunch for the lion. What else are key takeaways that Dr. Miles Monroe said? He said belief is so powerful, it makes an elephant act like a sheep in the presence of a lion and think he is a meal for a cat. Do you see that? Belief is so powerful, it makes an elephant act like a sheep in the presence of a lion and think he is a meal for a cat. Then he said something really powerful. Dr. Monroe said, what you think is more important than what you do. Again, what you think is more important than what you do, because what you think will actually control the things that you do. Remember some of the key takeaways from our teaching on rediscovering the transformative power and the value of the gospel of the kingdom that we learned in a previous lesson. We learned that because our mind or soul is the mediator or transmitter or interpreter between our spirit and our body, it makes no difference how saved or anointed we are. We can never fulfill our potential in God unless and until our souls or our minds are changed and renewed. This is why Paul said the following to us through his letter to the church at Rome. Paul said here in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 to 2, he said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Then look at what Paul says to us here in Romans 12 and 2. He says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Paul is simply letting us know that true and lasting transformation in our lives will only come through the renewal of our minds or a material change in the way that we think. The way we think will only change when we have a better understanding or revelation of who we are or of our disposition or of our identity. Remember what Paul said to us through his letter to the Ephesians. This is Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. The Bible says, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. Indeed, Paul is speaking about our God here. He says, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. But he concluded by saying, according to the power that worketh in us. So we are able to limit or determine God's ability to work in our lives based on the power that is at work in our lives. In other words, the power that works in us has a material impact on what God is able to do for us. The power that works in us has a material impact on what God is able to do for us. A revelation of who we are or of our disposition will have a material impact on the power that works in us. Therefore, Jesus sought to qualify us to advance his kingdom restoration program through the transformative power of the gospel of the kingdom. Again, therefore, Christ Jesus sought to qualify us to advance his kingdom restoration program through the transformative power of the gospel of the kingdom. Christ Jesus wanted us to change the way that we think. This is why the very first words of Jesus' public ministry are so very important. Here is a record of Jesus' initial public declaration as recorded in the book of Matthew. This is Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. The Bible says, from that time, that's from John's incarceration, from the time that John was put into prison, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Again, we reiterate that these were the first words of Jesus' public ministry. This was, for all intents and purposes, Jesus' mission statement.
which served to outline the purpose for his mission on the earth. But let's not overlook the first word of Jesus' public ministry. The first word of Jesus' public ministry is this word, repent. Now, the word repent in this context means to think differently. It means to reconsider, or it means to change the way that we think. Jesus was simply letting us know that if we are going to experience the benefits from the arrival of the kingdom of heaven, we needed to repent or change the way that we think or reconsider or learn to think differently. As believers, our ability to experience true victory and walk in the kingdom authority that Christ Jesus has made available to us is based on the extent to which our minds are renewed, which will be reflected in our attitudes and the way we act, which is a product of what we believe from the Word of God. Again, as believers, our ability to experience true victory and walk in the kingdom authority that Christ Jesus has made available to us is based on the extent to which our minds are renewed, which will be reflected in our attitudes and the way we act, which is a product of what we believe from the Word of God. Now, we have a few classic examples of this from the Word of God. Now, here are the instructions that God gave to Brother Moses, even regarding the children of Israel, as they were about to take possession of the promised land. Here it is. This is Numbers chapter 13, verse 2. Here's the word that our God gave to Brother Moses to speak to the children of Israel. God told Moses, "Send thou men that they may search the land of Canaan, which I give unto the children of Israel. Of every tribe of their fathers shall ye send a man, every one a ruler among them." Notice what God told Brother Moses. God told Brother Moses to search the land of Canaan, which I give unto the children of Israel. And so the land was theirs according to the promise from our God and his commitment to the covenant that he had made with Father Abraham. He told them to search the land of Canaan, which I give unto the children of Israel. We're just letting the people of God see from the Word of God how we react differently, even though we might see the exact same thing that someone else sees, but we respond differently based on our attitude, which is a product of what we believe. But our God told them to search the land of Canaan, which he said, "I give unto the children of Israel." A leader was chosen from each of the 12 tribes of Israel, and they went and they surveyed the land. Here's what happened upon their return. This was the report from 10 of the 12 leaders that went to spy out the land. This is Numbers chapter 13, verses 26 to 29. This is the report from 10 of the 12. Now, the Bible says, "And they went and came to Moses and to Aaron and to all the congregation of the children of Israel unto the wilderness of Paran to Kadesh, and brought back word unto them and unto all the congregation, and shewed them the fruit of the land." And so these 10 men came back from spying out the land. They showed Aaron and Moses and the children of Israel, the congregation of Israel, they showed them the fruit of the land. But here's what they said. This is Numbers chapter 13, verse 27. "And they told them and said, We came unto the land whither thou sentest us, and surely it floweth with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it." And so they showed them the fruit of the land. This is the fruit of it. Look at how big these grapes are and these fruit. This is wonderful fruit. This is a very rich land. But this is where things went south. Here it is in verse 28 of Numbers 13. They said, "Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there." Here it is in verse 29 of Numbers 13. "The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, and the Hittites, and the Jebusites, and the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and by the coast of Jordan." And so these 10 leaders were acting like God was not aware that these giants were in the land. God knows all things, and so he told them to go and spy out the land which I have given to you already. But nevertheless, they continued their report. Here it is in Numbers chapter 13, verses 31 to 33. They said, "We be not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we." Here it is in verse 32. "And they brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, the land through which we had gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof, and all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. Here it is in verse 33. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which came of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. Notice what they said. They said, we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. These 10 men did not speak to the giants. They had no interaction with them. But somehow they knew that these people saw them as grasshoppers. They said, we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. And so they had no communication with these people, but somehow they looked at them. And it was because of their attitudes. It was because of their lack of faith in the ability of their God. Because they were looking at their own strength. They were looking at the resources that they had access to in the physical realm, and determined that there's no way that they could defeat these giants that were in the land. They said, we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. But guess what? I did a bit of research, and because I wanted to know exactly what these people thought about the children of Israel. I did some research, and I actually found out exactly what these giants thought about the children of Israel. Now, Rahab the harlot from Jericho, she revealed exactly what people thought about the children of Israel. Here's what Rahab the harlot said to the two spies that Joshua had sent out. Here it is. This is Joshua chapter 2, verses 9 to 11. The 10 leaders of the tribes of Israel, they said, we were in our own eyes as grasshoppers, and so we were in their eyes. But Rahab lets us know exactly what these people thought about the children of Israel. This is Joshua chapter 2, verses 9 to 11. She said, I know that the Lord hath given you the land, and that your terror is fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. And so you begin to see the conditions were the exact opposite, that these 10 leaders, these 10 people who went to spy out the land, that they thought, Rahab said, your terror has fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. Rahab continues here in verse 10 of Joshua 2, for we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when ye came out of Egypt, and what you did unto the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side, Jordan, Sihon, and Og, whom ye utterly destroyed. Rahab concludes here in Joshua 2 and 11. The Bible says, and as soon as we had heard these things, our heart did melt. Neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and in earth beneath. And so, despite what these 10 leaders said, in reality, all the men on the other side of the river Jordan were terrified of the children of Israel because of the things that our God had done in drying up the Red Sea before them, in giving them victories over the powerful kings of the Amorites, Og and Sihon. But unfortunately, because of their attitudes, which were products of what they believed, these 10 leaders brought up an evil report of inevitable defeat, which served to weaken and discourage the children of Israel. But there were two other leaders who went to spy out the land. Remember, 12 of them went out. There were two other leaders. The two other leaders were Joshua and Caleb. Now remember, all 12 of these people, they looked at the exact same thing. They saw the giants. They saw the big fruit and the land flowing with milk and honey. But we heard the report of those 10. Now let's get an idea of what these other two young men said. This is Numbers chapter 13, verse 30. The Bible says here, and Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. And so we began to see that these good gentlemen, they had a totally different report, even though they saw the exact same thing. Remember, we said that we don't see with our eyes, we see through our eyes. We see with our minds, which is a product of what we believe or what is in our spirits. And so certainly Joshua and Caleb, they had a different mind. They had a different heart. They had a different attitude. Even though they had eyes like the other 10, they saw things exactly different from those 10 leaders. Caleb said, "Let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to possess the land." Their minds were renewed by faith in the word, power, and ability of God. But they continued to encourage the children of Israel. Here it is in Numbers chapter 14, verses 6 to 9. The Bible says, "And Joshua the son of Nun, and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, which were of them that searched the land, rent their clothes." Here it is in verse 7. "And they spake unto all the company of the children of Israel, saying, The land which we passed through to search it is an exceeding good land." In verse 8, they said, "If the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it us, a land which floweth with milk and honey." And so we begin to see that these two men had an entirely different report from the 10. Here it is in verse 9 of Numbers 14. They said, "Only rebel not ye against the Lord, neither fear ye the people of the land, for they are bread for us. Their defense is departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Fear them not." My fellow believer, all 12 of these men viewed the same land, but 10 of them saw inevitable defeat for the children of Israel. And conversely, because of their faith in God's ability, Caleb and Joshua brought a report of inevitable victory for Israel. What eventually happened was that the 10 leaders were killed by God because they brought up an evil report, and conversely, because they followed God fully and were confident in his ability to bring them victory, Caleb and Joshua entered and possessed the land. What they believe made all the difference in the world, my fellow believer. In this hour, God is calling us to be transformed by the renewing of our minds and focus more on what we cannot see than what we can see. Again, in this hour, our God is calling on us to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And he also wants us to focus more on what we cannot see. That's the invisible King of heaven from his invisible kingdom. He wants us to focus on the word of God, and he wants us to focus on his ability and his faithfulness. This is why Paul said the following to us in his letter to the Corinthians. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18. Paul said, "While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal." And so, my fellow believer, look at what Paul said. Paul encourages us to look, not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. My fellow believer, those 10 spies, they looked at the things that were seen. They were not focusing on that which they could not see, which is the invisible King of heaven and the resources from his invisible kingdom. This resulted in their death, my fellow believer. But Paul encourages us to look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. Let's take a closer look at this word look that Paul highlights here. This word look is the Greek word skopeo. That's S-K-O-P-E-O. This word means to take aim at. It means to focus on. It means to regard. It means to consider, take heed, and to mark. We are encouraged then to look at or focus more on the unseen than the seen. This is why Jesus calls us to repent or learn to think differently or change the way that we think. Why? Because the invisible yet powerful kingdom of heaven has arrived, my fellow believer. Just like those 10 spies, they looked at the physical realm. They focused on the physical realm and saw inevitable defeat. But those two men, Caleb and Joshua, their focus was on the invisible realm, and they experienced the victory, and they entered the promised land, and they experienced the benefits of the promises that our God gave to Father Abraham. Focusing on the unseen is the pathway to victory. This is why the Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, Paul said, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." This is the time for us to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, but this is the dispensation where we need to focus more on what we cannot see than on what we can see. The Bible says that the things which are seen, they are temporal. They are subject to change. But the things which are not seen, our God is eternal, my fellow believer. And his words and his promises and his counsel and his purpose, they stand forever. He will indeed do all his pleasure. Now, another person who was transformed by the renewing of his mind and who was not moved by what he saw was a little boy named David. Now, remember, a well-equipped giant named Goliath, he tormented and challenged the children of Israel. Here's what Goliath said. This is 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 8 to 11. We just helping the people of God to understand that we need to focus more on the invisible realm. We need to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, because it is our attitudes that will determine what we do for God and also what our God is able to do for us. Remember, we just saw in Ephesians 3:20, the Bible says our God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, but it is according to the power that works in us. But let's take a look at this other young gentleman who was transformed by the renewing of his mind. This young man was not moved by what he saw, but he focused on the invisible King of heaven from which he received his strength and his support. This is Goliath challenging the children of Israel. He was tormenting them. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 8 to 11. Goliath said, "Why are ye come out to set your battle in array? Am not I a Philistine, and ye servants to Saul?" He said, "Choose you a man for you, and let him come down to me." Here it is in verse 9 of 1 Samuel 17. He said, "If he be able to fight with me and to kill me, then will we be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then shall ye be our servants and serve us." Here it is in verse 10. "And the Philistine said, I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together." Here it is in verse 11. The Bible says, "When Saul and all Israel heard those words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid." And how did this fear cause them to react? Well, the Bible says in 1 Samuel 17, 24 to 25, "And all the men of Israel, when they saw that man, fled from him and were sore afraid. And the men of Israel said, Have ye seen this man that has come up? Surely to defy Israel is he come up." Notice the reaction of Saul and the other men of Israel. They were dismayed. They were greatly afraid. But there's a young man named David who saw and heard the exact same things that they heard and saw. But he reacted completely differently, like Caleb and Joshua. This young man, he reacted completely and totally differently. Even though he saw the exact same things that they saw, his attitude was different because of what he believed. And so this is the challenge to the people of God. While somebody else may look at a situation and see inevitable defeat, because we will be looking through the eyes of faith, because we will be focusing on the power and the ability and the resources of our invisible King and our Father, we too can begin to see things differently. We too can have a different attitude. We too can be transformed by the renewing of our minds. But this young man named David, he saw things completely different. And so here's what David said. This is 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 26. David asked the question, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" Notice David went to circumcision. Remember, circumcision was the symbol of our God's covenant with Father Abraham. God promised to protect and provide for those that are circumcised, the seed of Father Abraham. And so David immediately went to covenant. He said, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" Then David said in 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 32, he said, "Let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine." Well, my fellow believer, we all know what happened. David eventually went down into the valley and he used a stone to slay the giant. David had a completely different attitude. My fellow believer, David and the other men of Israel, they all saw and heard the exact same things, but their reaction and response were totally different. Why? Because of their attitudes and what they believed. Again, David and the other men of Israel, they all saw and heard the exact same things, but their reaction and response were totally different. Why? because of their attitudes and what they believed. Like the lion going against the elephant, David was not bigger, stronger, smarter, more powerful, well-trained, or well-equipped than Goliath, but he was still able to defeat him. Why? Because of his attitude, which was influenced by what he believed from the Word of God and his related experiences with God. Again, like the lion going against the elephant, David was not bigger, stronger, smarter, more powerful, well-trained, or well-equipped than Goliath, but he was still able to defeat him because of his attitude, which was influenced by what he believed from the Word of God and his related experiences with God. My fellow believer, David was transformed by the renewing of his mind. Now there's one other person who was transformed by the renewing of his mind, and as such he saw things completely different from everybody else. One other person, he too was transformed by the renewing of his mind. This person, of course, is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus was also transformed by the renewing of his mind, my fellow believer. Then others saw lepers who had an incurable disease. Jesus saw people who were cleansed and healed. Then others saw dead people to be grieved over. Jesus saw them as being alive and well. When others saw thousands of hungry people on the mountainside with no access to food, Christ Jesus saw filled people with surplus food. When the disciples saw a storm that could kill them, Jesus saw calm seas and a time to sleep or to take a nap in the midst of the storm. When others saw people filled with demons that were bound with spiritual and literal chains, Jesus saw delivered evangelists. When others saw cursing fishermen and crooked tax collectors, Jesus saw disciples who would finish his work. When others saw a man named Saul who persecuted the church, Jesus saw the greatest evangelist of all time and writer of more than half of the New Testament of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. When people saw a lame beggar at the temple gate, through his apostles, Christ Jesus saw a man walking and leaping and praising God. Then others saw people who were born blind or lame or had missing body parts. Jesus saw them as being every whit whole. When others saw a woman caught in adultery who should have been stoned to death, Jesus saw a forgiven evangelist. And finally, when people look at us and see our broken past, Jesus sees redeemed people who are enlightened sons of God, citizens of his heavenly kingdom, priests and kings who can walk in victory and experience the quality of life in God's kingdom or under God's government, and by God's Holy Spirit demonstrate the power and authority of the kingdom of heaven right here and right now. I think I need to say that again. When people look at us and see our broken past, Jesus sees redeemed people who are enlightened sons of God, citizens of his heavenly kingdom, priests and kings who can walk in victory and experience the quality of life in God's kingdom or under his government, and by God's Holy Spirit demonstrate the power and authority of the kingdom of heaven right here and right now. My fellow believer, it's time for us to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, so that we can see ourselves the way that Christ Jesus sees us and take up Jesus' mantle and continue his work of declaring, reclaiming, advancing, promoting, and expanding the kingdom of God on the earth. Again, it's time for us as believers to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, so that we can see ourselves the way that Christ Jesus sees us and take up Jesus' mantle and continue his work of declaring, reclaiming, advancing, promoting, and expanding the kingdom of God. This is why the Lord wants each and every one of us to experience victory and kingdom authority through the renewing of our minds. And so we praise the name of Jesus for this wonderful night. We thank him for this word that he has given to us. Again, I say, he gave this word to me, and it's something that I need to implement in my life. The Bible says in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, that we must needs be transformed by the renewing of our minds. I put it to you that God expects so much more from us than just to be Sunday go to meeting Christians or Saturday go to meeting Christians. This is a dispensation where we need to start walking in and manifesting the power and the authority of God's kingdom right here and right now. My fellow believer, Christ Jesus says a word to us. I believe it's Matthew chapter 16, around verse 19. Jesus said, "And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven." He said, "And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." And so, my fellow believer, in this dispensation, it's time for us to grab hold of our keys of the kingdom and access the resources that our God has made available to us from his word. Jesus says another word to us in St. John chapter 14, around verse 12. He says, "Verily I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do." Why? Because I'm going to the Father. I'm going to send Holy Spirit, Paracletos, Royal Governor, Comforter back, and he will empower us to do the exact same works that Christ Jesus did. My fellow believer, in this dispensation, this is a time where we need to walk in the power of our God. People need to see something different. Paul says to us, he says, "Through mighty signs and wonders, he fully preached the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." I believe that this is a dispensation where we need to fully preach the word of God by demonstrating the power of God. But my fellow believer, we need to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Sometimes we look around us and we seem to think that things are hopeless, but we need to understand that the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. And because God is with us, we can have the testimony of Caleb and Joshua. We can have the testimony of David. Despite what we see in the natural realm, as we focus, as we look at the things which are not seen more than the things which are seen, because the Bible teaches that the things which are seen, they are temporal, but the things which are not seen, they are eternal. And so we want to begin to focus on the invisible, because faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Our God is calling us to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. This is the only way that we would experience victory and kingdom authority through the renewal of our minds. Paul says that we will be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And so this is the dispensation for transformation through the renewal of our minds, so that we can walk in the power and the authority of the kingdom and experience the rights, privileges, and benefits of the kingdom of heaven. And so God bless you this wonderful night. Again, we appreciate God for you taking time from your busy schedule. Let's just close out in a word of prayer. Praise the name of Jesus as we close out tonight. Bless God. Hallelujah. Father, we come before in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, we come giving you thanks and praise, glory and honor, might and dominion and power. We thank you so much for this word, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Even now, my Father God, we begin to seal this word in the hearts of the people of God in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, that somebody's life, Father God, shall never be the same again. My Father, we thank you, Lord God, that someone is being transformed by the renewing of their minds. My Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we understand, my Father God, that even though we see through our eyes, my Father, we see with our hearts, we see, Lord God, with our minds, my Father God, which is the product of our attitudes, my Father God, which, Lord God, results, Father God, from what we believe. And so, my Father God, we thank you, my Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that even now, Lord God, you're strengthening your people with all might, Father God, in the inner man, Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lord God, we just begin to honor you, Lord God, and glorify you, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Again, Lord God, we declare that this word shall not fall by the wayside, shall not fall in stony ground, and shall not fall among the thorns, my Father. But this word has found good ground in the hearts of your people, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father God, we pray for a shaking and a moving, Father God, in the body of Christ, my Father, because the world still thinks that we're non-essential, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. And Father God, that we've opened up again, Father God, following the pandemic and basically doing the same things that we were doing before, Father God, the pandemic, the things that the people said were non-essential. And so, Father God, we understand that in this dispensation, you're calling on us to do some things that no other organization can do, my Father. Lord God, indeed, we feed, Father God, the poor, my Father God, in the name of Jesus. But then the Red Cross feeds the poor, my Father God. We give clothing, Father God, but indeed, Father God, the Kiwanis, Father God, and everybody else do those things. But Lord God, this is the dispensation where we need to begin to walk in a greater way in kingdom power and authority, my Father. Lord God, we need to open some blind eyes, some deaf ears, Lord God. Grow back some limbs, Father God, some maimed people. Raise some dead people, my Father God. Cleanse some lepers, oh God. Cast out some devils, oh God, in Jesus' name. For Jesus Christ himself declared, except ye see signs and wonders, you will not believe. And so, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, this is the time, my Father God, for life to be, Father God, injected into the body of Christ, my Father, where, Lord God, we will be transformed by the renewing of our minds, oh God, where we will walk, Father God, in the power, Lord God, that Jesus Christ has given us. The Bible teaches, my Father, that we have been blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, and then, Father God, we've been raised up and caused to sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And then, Father God, Christ Jesus said, my Father, that he has given us the keys of the kingdom, my Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, my Father God, I thank you, my Father God, that the people of God will begin to take hold of, Lord God, and appropriate the keys of the kingdom, my Father, and gain access, Lord God, to the immeasurable and inexhaustible resources from your kingdom right here and right now. As Lord God, Paul the Apostle lets us know that we, Lord God, are enlightened, my Father God. We are tasting of the heavenly gift. We, Father God, are tasting the good word of God, and we are right now able to taste the power of the age to come in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, my Father, because Holy Spirit is the earnest of our inheritance, oh God, in the name of Jesus Christ. And so, Lord God, again, we thank you for the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you, my Father. Lord God, we pray that the eyes of our understanding would be enlightened, oh God, we would know what is the hope of our calling and what is the exceeding greatness of your power to us who believe, which you wrought in Christ when you raised him from the dead, Lord God, and set him, Father God, in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, Lord God, but in the world which is to come. You gave Jesus Christ, Lord God, to be the head of all things, and you put all things under his feet. Father God, we thank you because we are his body. Lord God, things have been placed under our feet, for indeed, Lord God, our feet, Lord God, are attached to the body. We thank you, my Father, and you're calling us, my Father, Lord God, to walk, Father God, in victory, Lord God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. For Lord God, there must needs be a greater manifestation of kingdom power and authority. But Lord God, we begin, Father God, with the renewing of our minds, my Father. For we see ourselves, my Father God, as Christians, my Father God, who dress up nicely on Saturday and Sunday, sing some songs, Lord God, clap our hands, Lord God, and run up and down in church, my Father God. But in the name of Jesus Christ, my Father, unfortunately, there's minimal kingdom influence and power in us, Lord God. For we know, Lord God, that this is the dispensation, because your word declares, oh God, that this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. And so, my Father God, I thank you that you're raising up a people, my Father God, who will, Lord God, take the mantle of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and continue with the work that he started while he was on the earth. The work, Father God, of declaring, reclaiming, advancing, promoting, and expanding the kingdom of God here on the earth, my Father. We begin to pray like Jesus taught us to pray. We pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father God, we begin to pray that your governing influence, your sovereign rulership, Lord, your reign, Father God, your royal power, Father God, would come, my Father God, so that your will would exclusively be done on the earth, Father God, as it is in heaven, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus. Your kingdom come, Lord, your will be done, Father God, on earth, as it is in heaven, my Father. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, O God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, we just bless your holy precious name. Even now, Father God, we begin to lift up our unsaved family members, those we know, those we don't know, Lord God, who might not be born again. We begin to, Father God, declare the kingdom of God has come unto them, Lord God. We begin to pray, oh God, Father God, that you turn their hearts toward you, my Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray, oh God, that you give them hearts to love you and serve you, my Father God, in Jesus' name. Father God, we take authority over every spirit that's seeking to hold them in the kingdom of darkness. We pray for our loved ones, Father. We pray for our children. We pray for our family members. We pray for our friends. Father God, again, we take authority, Father God, over those spirits that would seek to keep them in the kingdom of darkness, my Father. Thank you for turning hearts toward you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Even now, my Father God, we begin to lift up the people of God. Perhaps, Lord God, the saints of God, we begin to pray for strength for the people of God. You began to pray, Lord God, that the people of God be strengthened with all might, my Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, Lord God, Christ Jesus said that the kingdom of God cometh not with observation, neither shall we say, lo here or lo there. For behold, the kingdom of God is within us, my Father. And so, Lord God, because your kingdom is within us, your kingdom is on the inside of us, your kingdom is in our midst, my Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, my Father, we can experience, Lord God, the benefits and rights and privileges and power and authority of your kingdom. Your kingdom is in our midst, my Father God. And for this reason, we lift up the people of God. Even now, perhaps someone, Lord God, is listening, Lord Father God, who has some type of sickness in their bodies, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we just began to pray, my Father, for healing, Lord God, in the bodies of the people right now. Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we just began to release kingdom power and authority right now, my Father. We take authority, Father God, over every sickness, Father God, in the bodies of the people of God. Father God, we thank you, my Father God, for Christ Jesus. Father God, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, my Father. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Father God, we thank you that Christ Jesus took our infirmities and he bore our sicknesses. And because he took it and bore it, my Father God, we don't have to take it and bear it anymore. For indeed, with his stripes we are healed. And so, Father God, we thank you, Lord God, for manifestation of the healing, Lord God, that you've made available to the people of God even now. Father God, we take authority, Father God, over every spirit of infirmity right now. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we begin to release kingdom power and authority, my Father. Lord God, even as Christ Jesus declared that virtue, Father God, was released from his body, Lord God, to bring healing, Lord God, to that woman with the issue of blood. Father God, we begin to release, Lord God, the healing virtue, Father God, from your kingdom right now. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, every spirit of infirmity is driven from the bodies of the people of God, my Father. Lord God, we speak to that demon of cancer, my Father God, and drive it from the bodies of the people of God in the name of Jesus. Every sickness, every disease, my Father God, Lord God, sugar, diabetes, Father God, hypertension, heart disease, my Father God, lupus, my Father God, every sickness, every disease, Lord God, we take authority, Father God, over every sickness, Father God, every disease, Father God, cataracts in the eyes, my Father God, problems with the legs, my Father, we speak peace, Father God, to the minds of the people of God. We speak strength, Lord God, to those limbs, Lord God, and healing, Lord God, to the bodies of the people of God. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you, Lord God, because you have spare parts. Perhaps someone, Lord God, has an arm or leg missing, my Father, because we know that Christ Jesus healed, Lord God, even those who were maimed. We begin to thank you for growing back body parts right now. Father God, this is where our faith is, and Christ Jesus said, according to your faith, be it unto you. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Father God, we thank you, my Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that some dead person is being raised right now by the power of the Holy Ghost. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Father God, we stand, Lord God. Father God, it's your plenipotentiaries, oh God. We stand, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, as your ambassadors, your diplomats, and your envoys, oh God. And Father God, we speak with the power vested in us, Father God, as your ambassadors, oh God, as those with plenipotentiary powers, those, Father God, who carry the full weight and backing of the kingdom of heaven. We declare healing and wholeness to the people of God even now. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we declare the kingdom of God is coming to the people of God, and again drive every spirit of infirmity, for the word of God declares how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. Jesus went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. For Lord God, you were with him, O God, and even as you were with Christ Jesus, Father, you are with us even now. And for this reason, my Father God, we know that we have access to the same kingdom resources, O God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, we thank you that the kingdom of God is in our midst, and for this reason, we are able, O God, to experience, Lord God, the culture, power, and authority of your kingdom, Father God, right here and right now. We thank you that your word declares, my Father, because we serve you, oh God, you promised to bless our bread and our water, and you promised to take sickness and disease from the midst of us. Again, your word declares that because we've made you, even the Most High, our habitation, there shall no evil befall us, and no plague shall come nigh our dwelling. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, that we as your ambassadors will begin to walk in our diplomatic community, because your word declares that we are able to, Father God, experience right now, my Father, Lord God, the powers, we are able to taste the powers of the age to come, and we know that there's no sickness, there's no disease in the age to come, Father God, and we thank you that we are able, my Father God, to be partakers, Lord God, of the rights and privileges and benefits from the age to come, right here and right now. And so, my Father God, we give you praise, glory, and honor, my Father, might and dominion, Father God, and power, Lord, we just bless you again, my Father, for this wonderful night, my Father God. Again, we say the kingdom of God is coming to the people of God, and we declare healing and wholeness Thank you, Lord God. Father God, for meeting the needs of your people. For your word declares, Lord God, that you will supply our need according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. We know that there's no recession, no depression, no inflation in heaven, my Father. Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, and because we are citizens of your heavenly kingdom, we thank you that the government of the kingdom of heaven is now responsible for us, and you will supply our need according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And so we thank you for meeting every need of the people of God, whether it be financial, whether it be emotional, whether it be spiritual, whether it be physical. Lord God, we are wayward kids, Lord. We thank you for turning those kids around, setting their lives in order, my Father God. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for meeting every need, supplying every need for your people, my Father. We thank you, Lord God, because your word declares that we know the grace of God, that though Jesus Christ was rich, yet for our sake he became poor, that we through his poverty might become rich. And indeed, James says, my Father God, hearken, my beloved brethren, hath not our God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he had promised to them that love him? We thank you, my Father, that we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. And for this reason, Holy Father, we, Father God, have inherited all things. Lord, we just praise you again. We say the kingdom of God is coming to the people of God. Thank you for strengthening in your people, my Father. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for shaking us, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for transforming us by the renewing of our minds this night, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Again, we say the kingdom of God has come to the people of God, and we say amen and amen. Bless the name of Jesus.
You've been listening to a message by Pastor Ezeal McFaul, kingdom citizen and ambassador of Christ. We trust that this message has been a blessing to you, and that in some small way, it has helped you to become more knowledgeable about God's kingdom and his righteousness. It is our prayer that God grants you a heart that hungers and thirsts after his kingdom and his righteousness, so that you will be filled or supplied and begin to experience the abundant life that Christ Jesus came to make available to his children. If you desire further information about our ministry or access to additional resources, please feel free to contact Pastor McFaul at 242-427-5512 or internationally at 954-284-7909. Dare to take God at his word. Seek his kingdom and his righteousness. Be delivered from the spirit of religion and begin to live life on another level. God bless you is our prayer.
Let the kings worship him today. Let the kings worship him today.